show up for lab. Okay, I believe this is where we left off.
Yes, no, maybe so, guys?
Yes.
Okay. So we did the bottom one on the bottom right-hand corner. So let's go back to the one at the top left and take a look at that and name it. So the first thing we're going to want to do is what? Yes, find the parent chain, and that's going to be the longest continuous chain. And we're just going to pick one. So usually, most of us will just go left to right and pick the easiest one first. And that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 there. So that would be a pentane. Or we could go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so we see that we've got a lot of pentanes, so a lot of possibilities for our parent chain. So IUPAC says that if you have that, if you have a lot of possibilities, you're going to choose the one that has the most what on it? Branches. So we have to take a look at that. So if we did 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this right here would be the branch. That would be an isopropyl branch, but we'd only have one branch. If we do this chain right here, we have two branches, a methyl and an ethyl. If we do this right here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we have a methyl and an ethyl, so that looks like it's the same as the one that we just did. Does anyone see another one that would have more than two branches? No? Okay, so do we want to go with the easy one right in the middle there, guys?
Yeah.
Okay, so the next thing we have to do is decide what?
Numbering.
So do we want to number it left to right or right to left?
Yes.
Right to left. Right to left. We want to number it backwards because our first branch will come on the second carbon. If we numbered it forwards, our first branch would be on the third carbon, and IUPAC says you're going to pick the option that gives you the lower number. So we're going to go ahead and number this backwards. And if we're just writing down our thought process, our parent chain, or our principal chain, oh, why did I write parents again? Because I'm crazy. Okay, so our parent chain is pentane. And we have a couple of branches. The first one being, what's right there, you guys? I already said it. Methyl. And that's located on carbon 2, so that's 2-methyl. And we also have what?
Ethyl.
And that's located on carbon 3 of the parent chain, so that's 3-ethyl. Okay, so remember our brains are going to want to put the 2 before the 3 in the name, but IUPAC says that we're going to go with what?
Alphabetical order.
We're going to go with alphabetical order, and we look at the names. So we have M versus E. So who comes first in the name?
The ethyl.
So we have a 3-ethyl. Keep going for me, you guys.
Yes.
3-ethyl-2-methyl-pentane, and we want to make sure that we have dashes when we have a number next to a letter. And we want to put a comma when we have two numbers in a row, but we don't have that in this example here. So just in case someone walked in late, does everybody have the handout for today? Anybody else need this? Okay. There's just a couple of slides that weren't on the version PowerPoint file that you made. Okay, so let's do the one to the right. So it looks like a little dog there. So what's the parent chain on that one, you guys?
One, two, three, or 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3,
two, three, four. We're gonna have two branches here and two branches there, so that gives us four branches. If we went one, two, three, four, we have these two as branches and these two as branches, so that's four branches again. And if you do it different ways, you're gonna find that you have four branches any of the ways that you go. Does that make sense, you guys? This is pretty symmetrical little molecule here. So most of us will do something like this, because we like to go left to right, right, you guys? So let me just highlight this right here. And of course, if you guys wanted to go like that, it would be exactly the same thing. Okay, so at each of the ends of our lines, we have carbons, and at each of the points, we have carbons, because that's what we have to assume with our line bond structures. So at the ends of the little legs on the bottom there, if you guys want to draw in your carbons just to know what you've got, you put the C there, and then you'd have to say, okay, I know when the carbon's on the end there, it's going to have how many hydrogens?
Three,
because those hydrogens will surround the carbons, and the carbon will also be bonded to the carbon that's part of the parent chain up here, okay? So these two groups are what, you guys?
Methyl
groups. Those are methyl groups. What about the little antenna at the top? Those are also methyl groups. Now remember, if you're a pro at this, you don't have to draw these in. I'm just drawing them in to show you what's there, okay? And also remember, CH3 is the same thing as H3C. I drew it like that just to remind you, okay? All right, this means that we've got four methyls. Two are on carbon two, and two are on carbon three. So if we number this, we're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, would it have mattered if I numbered backwards?
No,
because that still would have put two methyls on carbon 2 and two methyls on carbon 3. This is a symmetrical molecule, so it wouldn't have mattered. All right, you guys. So instead of listing them all out, let's just look at this and recognize, because I have four methyls, that's going to be called what in the name?
Tetramethyl.
Okay, if you have two of them, it's dimethyl, three of them, it's trimethyl, and if you have four of them, it's tetramethyl. Now, you need to tell your reader the location of all of those branches, even if they're the same, and even if they're on the same carbon. All right, if you've got four branches, you need to have four numbers. So I'm going to start with which two numbers?
Two.
I'm going to say 2, 2, what? What are the next two numbers?
3, 3,
and now I'm going to put a dash there because I'm going to do a letter. And that is going to be what?
Tetra.
Yeah, it's going to be T, and it's going to be followed by etra for tetra, and then what? Keep going for me, you guys. Tetramethyl butane. Good. So this name is telling us that our parent chain is a butane, so it has four carbons. What do we have on there? We have four methyl branches. Where are they located? Well, two of them are on carbon two of the parent chain, and the other two are on carbon three of the parent chain. Are we all right with this? Questions for me? Concerns? Complaints? Okie dokie. Alrighty, let's do the bottom left hand. So, what do we see there for the parent chain? Anybody? Okay, so somebody said pentane. So somebody is seeing a 5-carbon chain as the longest chain. So maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Whoever answered me, is that what you did? Something like that? Okay. So if we looked at this one right here, we'd see that that's 1, 2, 3, 4. So that would be a butane, so we'd rule that one out. 1, 2, 3, 4, or 1, Is everyone all right with that? Okay, so we've got this one right here, or it could be that or that. It's all the same. But let me go ahead and highlight it. So we've got this one right here. Now let's decide, you guys, are we going to number forwards or backwards? So most of you guys are saying we should number backwards because that would put two of our branches on carbon 2. And then some of you don't see it because you're looking at this guy over here, and we're not used to branches being straight like this. We like them up and down, right, you guys? Okay. But it might help if you go and you circle all the branches. Even though this is over here, this is still a branch because this is our parent chain right here. We could draw it down here and that would be a perfectly good drawing. It's just that it's not drawn like that. You have to recognize it. So if you need to, put a circle around all of your branches. Okay? So now we can see that we have three, what kind of branches?
Methyls.
Now, we can either have our first methyl off of carbon 3, or we can number it backwards and have our first branches off of carbon 2. And most of you guys told me that you want to number backwards so that we have the first two branches off of carbon 2, and that is correct. We're going to do okay on Monday when we take this exam? Yes? Because you're going to do all your homework this weekend and you're going to check the solutions that are on Canvas, right? Yes. And if you're having a major problem with any of the questions and you just can't get what the solution manual says, stop. Do not spend forever on that. Your time is precious, okay? Sometimes the solution manual is wrong, and sometimes it's just a little tiny thing you're not seeing. Take a picture of it, attach it to an email, and send that to me, or talk to me in lab about it. Okie dokie, Smokies. Okay, yes?
Do you provide like a study guide, or no?
Yes, I usually put it on Canvas. And what I do, you guys, is I make the exam, and then I just go, there's a question on this, there's a question on that, there's a question on this, and I just look straight down my exam, and I go and order.
So
I'm not tricky. If I taught it to you, it's important. If I didn't teach it to you, it's not on the test. I don't like zero in on little obscure things in the book and put that on the test. That's not me.
When would you post it?
Probably when I send the exam to the print shop. So that'll probably be Friday. Yeah. Does that make sense, you guys? Okay. So just watch for it. And if it's not there, feel free to email me and bug me. Is there a question up here, you guys?
No.
Okay, all right. So let's keep going. So let's go ahead and draw 2-bromo, 3-chloro, 4-fluoro, 2-3-4 trimethylheptane. That's a long one, but it's not that hard to draw. What you guys are gonna do first is draw what?
Heptane.
You're gonna look for the parent chain, and you're gonna draw heptane. And you're probably going to draw a caterpillar because you don't want to draw out all of those carbons and all of those bonds and all of those hydrogens because your time is important. Right, my friends? All right. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Could I have drawn that whole structure upside down, you guys?
Yes.
Could I have drawn it vertically? Absolutely. Okay. So, we've got 2-bromo. So what am I going to draw on carbon number 2? branch. It goes from bromine to bromo. Is that all right with you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So on carbon number 2, we're going to put a little leg and we're going to draw a bromine. Now at carbon number 3, what are you guys going to draw?
Chlorine.
So let's just draw a CL there. And make sure your L is lowercase L and not a capital L. And on the 4th carbon, what do you guys want?
A fluorine.
Is there anything else I need to draw in my structure? Yes, you guys need to draw the methyls. So we're going to go back to carbon 2. And you guys are going to draw a bond. And you're going to draw what at the end of the bond?
CH3.
If you guys did not want to draw CH3 at the end of that little line right there, would that be okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, because on the end, you've got a CH3. That's how line bond works. But if it's anything else, you're going to need to make sure that you draw something else. Like if it was ethyl, you'd have to have a corner and then a line down. And what I mean is this. I'll draw it right next to the chlorine. So next to the chlorine, I'm going to draw a methyl, and I'm just going to leave it as a line. Because in a line bond structure, all the points have carbons and all the ends have carbons unless stated otherwise. Okay? Does that make sense, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you can draw in the CH3 or you can not draw in the CH3. And what last thing am I missing on here?
The fourth.
Yes. So I need a methyl right there. Now you guys, could I have drawn the bromine on that carbon? Yes, when you're drawing the structure, you get to choose whether you're numbering forwards or backwards, okay? But everything else would have to be changed around too. So if you wanted the bromine here, you'd have to put the chlorine there, and then the fluorine would always be there. You guys get what I mean? We're okay with that? Alrighty, questions for me? Okay, so if you're numbering your groups and the numbering thing isn't resolved, like you don't have a 2-3 versus 3-5 or whatever it is, the first sided group gets the lower number. And what on earth am I talking about? Well, let's take a look at the structure below. So right here, we've got a methyl group. And right here, we've got an ethyl group. Can you guys see that okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So if we number forwards, we do this. And that would give us 3-methyl-5-ethyl. If we number backwards, what we would have is 3-ethyl-5-methyl. So we have a 3-5 either way. So remember back when we were trying to choose which way to number our parent chain? We went with whatever set gave us the lower numbers, but both of these are a 3-5. So a UPEC says, in case you ever come across something like this, then what you do is you go on to the letters over here. So just because we have to say one of them's 3 and the other one is 5, you're going to give the lower number to the letter that comes first in the alphabet. Okay, so this is one of those little obscure examples. It doesn't come up that often, but it is a rule. So for this one, are we going to go with the blue or the red, you guys?
Yeah, red.
The red. So we're going to have 3-ethyl, 5-methyl, heptane, and that looks exactly like what's written up there. Any questions for me, guys? up with this stuff. So it's really important that you're practicing, practicing, practicing. Okay? Again, this is not going to get in your head Sunday night. So make sure you're doing this homework every day. Okay, highly condensed structures. Sometimes you'll see structures written in a really weird way that might freak you out a little bit, but they're just doing it to save space. So if we take a look at this structure right here, what we have is a central carbon that's bonded to four methyl groups. So we can write that in shorthand like this. So we've got carbon connected to four methyl groups. Or in the backwards way, we've got four methyl groups connected to the central carbon. And this will be used in textbooks or online to save space where you don't need the whole structure. Something like this, you have two CHs. So it'll draw the CHs in the center and then say we've got two of these guys right here hanging off this CH and two of these guys right here hanging off of this CH. Are we okay with the different representations? Right with that? Okay. So there's not a whole lot of that I would ask you guys to draw on the test, but just be familiar with that, okay? Now, classification of carbons. This right here is what students tend to really like and hope there's 20 problems about on the exam because it's pretty easy. So, a primary carbon, excuse the formatting, when I save it to an updated version of PowerPoint, it puts spaces here, there, and everywhere on me. So a primary carbon is going to be a carbon that's bonded to one other carbon. So if you're bonded to one other carbon, you're going to be bonded to how many hydrogens, you guys?
30.
A secondary carbon, this is a carbon that's bonded to two other carbons. And if it's bonded to two other carbons, then it has a group for how many hydrogens?
Two
hydrogens. A tertiary carbon, this is a carbon that's bonded to three other carbons, and how many hydrogens?
One.
Yeah. And you've got one hydrogen on there. A quaternary carbon is a carbon that's bonded to four other carbons, and how many hydrogens?
Zero.
The structure below, you can see that there are a whole lot of primary carbons here. Again, those are carbons bonded to just one other carbon and three hydrogens. Your secondary carbons, these guys, you can see this one is bonded to this carbon and that carbon, which only leaves room for two hydrogens if we're following the octet rule, which we want to be following. And we've got our tertiary carbon right here. It's bonded to three different carbons and room for only one hydrogen on there. And our quaternary carbon is right here. It's bonded to these three and then the purple one over there. Are we all right with this, you guys? We can do some of these questions on the exam?
Yeah.
This one's usually pretty easy for students. So, similarly, hydrogens can be classified as primary, secondary, tertiary, or quaternary. And if you have a primary hydrogen, that's a hydrogen that's bonded to a primary carbon. Okay? So right here, you guys, these primary hydrogens, these are bonded to a primary carbon. And our secondary hydrogens, those are hydrogens bonded to what kind of carbons, you guys? Secondary carbons. And our tertiary hydrogens bonded to what kind of carbon?
Tertiary
carbon. And our quaternary hydrogen, what about that? Do we have a hydrogen bonded to a quaternary carbon?
No.
No, so quaternary hydrogens don't exist Because the carbon is like, no, I'm already bonded to four different things. There is no room for you. Go away, find somebody else to bond to. Does that make sense, you guys? Okay. So we don't have any quaternary hydrogens. Okay, so let's locate some primary carbons on this guy. We named this guy before. So let's go ahead and put in all of our primaries. So I'll do those in red, you guys. So you're just going to find the carbons that are where? On the end, the ones that are terminal. So I'll do the primaries in red. They're all here on the end. I have no idea why that line just appeared. Okay. So primary is in red. Then in blue, let's do our secondary carbons. Do we have secondary carbons here? Do we have any carbons that are bonded to two other carbons? Yeah, this one right here is bonded to two carbons, right? So, we have secondary carbon here. Anywhere else? What about the carbon to the right of the blue carbon?
Yes.
Yeah, that's another secondary carbon. What about the carbon to the right of those two blue carbons? Is that also secondary?
No.
No, because this carbon right here is bonded to 1, 2, 3, 4 different carbons. Do you guys see that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, are there any other secondary carbons up here? What about this one?
Mm-hmm.
Nope, because that's bonded to 1, 2, 3. What about this one? Is that a secondary carbon?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it's bonded to those two carbons right there. What about the carbon to the right of the one that I just put up there? Is that secondary?
Yes.
Yes, that one's secondary. Okay, so the secondaries I've drawn in blue. So let's do green for our tertiaries. We just went by a tertiary. Which one? This one or this one? The one to the left or the one on the right? Which one's tertiary here? The one on the right, is that a tertiary carbon?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so we've got a tertiary carbon there. Do we have any other tertiary carbons?
No.
So this one right here, is this a tertiary carbon?
No.
Nope, that's a quaternary carbon. It's connected to 1, 2, 3, 4 there. What about this one?
No.
That's a quaternary because it's connected to 1, 2, 3, 4. What about this one right here? Is that tertiary? That's a secondary one that we skipped over, right, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
So is it okay to go back and change the pen to blue and put secondary in secondary?
Mm-hmm.
Of course, we're learning. This happens. So we've got one tertiary carbon there. We're going to switch on back to blue so we can go, oh, we forgot to do those two down there, but that's okay. And then you guys have told me we've got a couple of quaternary carbons right here and right here. Are we okay with this? We can do this on the exam? Okay, good. Questions for me? All right. And then we can locate all of the hydrogens based on how the carbons are classified, right? Same thing, except the quaternary carbon is not going to have a hydrogen on it, so the quaternary hydrogen doesn't exist. Okay, so let's go on and let's do some cycloalkenes. So these are in fact alkenes. You just have a little ring. And we're going to have the prefix cyclo in our name. So if you have six carbons, you're going to be a hexane. But if those six carbons are in a ring, it's different from the six carbons that are in a chain, just straight six carbons. So we have to have a name change. And how we do that is we throw the prefix cyclo on the beginning, and that would be called a cyclohexane. Are you guys okay with that? All right. Now notice than a regular old hexane, because a regular old hexane, you've got CH3s on the end. And with a cyclohexane, in order to cyclize it, what you have to do is you have to pull the hydrogens off of the end so those carbons can bond to each other. So instead of being C6H14, the cyclohexane is going to be C6H12. So with our cycloalkanes, instead of being CnH2n+2, you're going to be CnH2n without the plus 2. Okay? So that's the general formula for the molecular formula. Are we okay with that, you guys? Okay, so how you guys will see the different forms, if you're looking at a full structural formula, it's going to draw out all of the atoms and all of the bonds. That's a lot of work. A little less work, we've got the condensed formula right there. Even less work is line bond, where you just go ahead and draw the lines. So all of the lines, those are bonds, and at each point you have a what?
Carbon.
A carbon. But if all that you're seeing is this, you're not drawing this, what it asks you to do is assume that at all the points you have a carbon, and that you're going to figure out how many hydrogens are on each of those carbons. So if this carbon right here is bonded to two other carbons, that leaves room for how many hydrogens to be bonded to it?
Two.
And you can see that here and here. So with the line bond structure, those are easiest to draw because they're easy to draw and because you don't have a chance of making a mistake with number of hydrogens there. But if that's all you're given, you gotta be able to figure out where the hydrogens are and how many. Okie dokie smokies? Okay. All right, so what we're gonna do is start with cyclopropane for our cycloalkenes, because there is no cyclomethane or cycloethane. Why, you guys? Too small. How do you make a cyclic structure with a single carbon, right? It doesn't like bond to itself and make a circle. And then if you just have two of them, they can just bond to each other, but that's just a line. There's no cyclic structure. But once you get three of them, then you can make a triangle, and that's a cyclic structure. Does that make sense, you guys? Okay, so then you have a ring. So the first ring we're going to see is cyclopropane and how we name those. So the nomenclature rules pretty much follow the nomenclature rules that we learned for the straight chain alkanes, except you have a cyclo in there somewhere, and there's a few other considerations that we have to factor in, okay? So if we're looking at the first one, the parent chain is going to be cyclobutane. When we did straight chains, we said the longest continuous carbon chain that you have without picking up your pencil. Now, if we were following that rule literally, we'd say, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But we don't do it that way when we have the cyclic structures. What we look for is we look for the biggest cyclic structure, and right here there's only one, and that's a cyclobutane. And then we name things that are hanging off of that structure as branches. So our parent chain is going to be cyclobutane. Cyclo because it's cyclic, and butane because that's how many carbons, you guys?
Four.
And what's hanging off of it? What is the branch right there?
Methyl.
And we plop that on the front. Now notice that there's no number there. That's because if there's only one branch hanging off of the square here, then that carbon right there that it's hanging off of has to be carbon number what?
One.
Because IUPAC says you have to give it the lowest number possible. So when numbering this, you go, okay, I've got four choices. I need that methyl to have the lowest number possible. So I'm going to go 1, 2, 3, 4. Or you guys could
one, two, three, four, absolutely does not matter as long as that methyl's on carbon one. Does that make sense, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Now, in chemistry, you guys saw before that if you don't have a number, you assume that it's what?
One.
Like when we have H2O, it's telling you there's two hydrogens and one oxygen, even though in the formula it doesn't say H2O1 at the bottom. You guys remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if you guys put one methyl cyclobutane, would it be wrong?
Mm-hmm.
No, you just don't have to do that. Okay, does that make sense to us? Okay. So the next one, we're going to have another cyclobutane. So the cyclic structure is the parent, and those things hanging off of them are the branches. Now we've got two methyl groups hanging off of them, and we need to figure out how we're going to number the parent chain, which is the box, and we're going to want to give those branches the lowest number possible. So we're going to start one of the branches on carbon number what?
One.
One, okay? So you guys can call this number one or this number one, because either way you're going to have methyls on one and three. So one, two, three, or one, two, three, or one, two, three, or one, two, three. Can you guys see how no matter what way you go, you're going to have a 1,3 dimethyl? Okay. So just choose something. See that you're going to have a 1,3 dimethyl cyclobutane. Now, the common student mistake with these types of questions is to forget the cyclo. If you just write butane, that is a different answer. You're saying that you have a straight chain of four carbons as your parent chain. Does that make sense to us? Okay, so don't forget the cyclo. Now, looking at the next one, the top substituent or the top branch is methyl, and then the bottom one is what? No, G. Is ethyl. We usually like it CH2, CH3, but occasionally we see it like that. So we've got a methyl and an ethyl there. Now, the methyl and the ethyl are going to be on carbons 1 and 2, right, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because you want the lowest number possible, so you wouldn't start over here and go, I want this to be carbon 1. So I'm going to go 1, 2, 3, and I'm going to have 3 and 4. A UPAC says, no, that's wrong, and your instructor has to take off points for that. So you're going to do 1, 2, or 1, 2. And here we have that rule where a UPAC said if you have the same numbers either way, then you give the lower number to which one? The one that comes first in the alphabet. So notice we did 1-ethyl-2-methyl, so we went 1-2 instead of 1-2. Are you guys all right with that? So we've got 1-2 like that, and that's because E comes before M there, okay? And that you won't see super often, but you gotta know that, okay? So 1-ethyl-2-methylcyclohexane. Okay, say you have a branch hanging off of your cyclic structure, and the straight chain branch has more carbons than the number of carbons in your cyclic structure, okay? So there are 5 carbons here, and there are 3 carbons here. What IUPAC says is now you're going to switch this. Because there's 5 carbons here, this is the parent chain, and this is your branch here. Okay? So you're going with the bigger one. So the parent chain here, it's 5 carbons long, so that means it's a what? That means it's a pentane. So you guys can see that there's pentane on the end right there. Okay? Now, this one only has 3 carbons, so that would be some kind of propyl. It's not regular propyl, it's not isopropyl, it's what?
Cyclopropyl.
It's cyclopropyl. So if all you guys had was this structure right here, it would be called cyclopropane. Does that make sense, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if all you have is propane and then you're making that a branch, the name goes from propane to propyl.
the name goes from cyclopropane to cyclopropyl if it's a branch. Does that make sense to us? Yes, no, maybe so, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so since this is a branch, it's now called cyclopropyl, and we need to identify where the cyclopropyl is, and you guys can see right here, it's one cyclopropyl pentane. Okie dokie, Smokies. If the cyclopropyl was coming off of this carbon, how would the name change? If this right here was moved to this carbon, yes, it would be 3-cyclopropyl pentane. Are we making sense? We're good?
Is the one necessary even though it only has one branch?
Not technically, but when you get bigger and bigger straight chains, you tend to see the number appear more often. It's one of those little weirdnesses. And I will not put things to trick you on the test, you guys, okay? That's not my cup of tea. If I do something like that, it would be extra credit at the end. Okay. All right. So, any questions on this?
Does the same rule apply where it says you don't count like the prefix so the dashi? There was an example in the homework, and it started. It was like 4-ethyl. It was like 4-ethyl-1-1-methyl. But what if ethyl could the lower number?
You only have to debate who gets the lower number if the numbering systems would be exactly the same forwards or backwards. So if you had like 2-5 versus 3-8 or something like that, you would go with 2-5. This one right here, you would have a 1-2 or a 1-2, either way. And there's another one of those back here that we did. Yes. So this one you'd have a 3-5 or a 3-5. They're exactly the same. So then you would pick based on alphabetization. The examples that we did before, don't confuse them, because we picked which way we numbered them with this one because we had 3-3-5 and 3-5-5, so the numbering was different. Do you guys get what I mean here? Okay, so this one, it didn't matter with the alphabet because you have a clear one right here that you have to choose. You would only go, okay, I need to do the alphabetization if I had 3-3-5 and 3-3-5. Are we okay with that, you guys? Okay. So do your two numbering systems first, okay? And then if one of them is obviously lower at the first point of difference, then you go with that one and you don't worry about the E and the M and the P and all of that. But if you would have the exact same numbering both ways, like 3 and 5 and 3 and 5, that's when you go, okay, the ethyl gets the 3 and the methyl gets the 5. Are we okay with that? Okay. Okay, so let's name some of these. So does anyone want to do the little spermy looking guy there? No, everyone wants me to do it. Okay, that cyclic structure, that cycloalkene there, has how many carbons?
8.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Does everybody see that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let me just draw the carbons in because I want to point out to you guys that this carbon right here belongs to the cyclic structure. So the first carbon of the branch doesn't start until right there. branch has four carbons, so the parent is going to be the cyclic structure. If you have a cyclic structure with eight carbons, you have a what? A cyclooctane. Good. You have a cyclooctane. That looks like cyclooctane. What is your branch?
One.
What is it, you guys? Four carbons?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's a butyl. Now, which carbon of the cyclic structure is that butyl connected to? Carbon one. It has to be carbon one, okay? You don't want to number the cyclic structure so that your branch is hanging off of carbon three if you don't have to. So we can put one butyl cyclooctane, or what could we call this?
Butyl
cyclooctane. Either answer is correct. Are we all right with this?
Okay.
The second one, who's the parent? They're both four. So what we have is we have a cyclic structure with four carbons, and we have a branch with four carbons. And remember where they connect right there, that carbon belongs to the cyclic structure. What IUPAC says is if you have this situation where they both have the same number of carbons, the cyclic structure wins out for the parent. Because you just have to make a choice and they made it for you. Okay? So, what is our branch called, you guys?
Butyl.
So we have butyl what? Cyclobutane. Butyl cyclobutane. If I wanted to call it something else, I would add in a number and a hyphen, and that would be what?
One
butyl cyclobutane. Both answers are correct. Anyone have a problem with that one? I really need to bring a box of tissues for this classroom because the sandpaper is doing a number on my nose. That's going to sound really good on the video, huh? She blows her nose. I have to listen to that. Okay, so let's do the little chicken structure at the bottom. So who's going to be the parent here? The cyclic structure. And how many carbons does that have?
Six.
That has six. So that's going to be called what?
Cyclohexane.
Don't forget the cyclo. Cyclohexane. Let's list our branches. See if we can do that. So the two at the bottom, those should be pretty obvious. Those are what? Methyl. So we have a methyl, and we have a methyl. So that's going to give us dimethyl. And you guys, you do not have to write any of this. I'm just kind of writing down the thought process. What else do we have?
Isopropyl.
Yes, the little snake right here, that's isopropyl. We have one, two, three carbons in that branch, which means it's some kind of propyl group, and it's connected by the center carbon, which means it's an isopropyl. So if you didn't see this right here, and it had another line right here, so it was one, two, and then at the end here, that would be three. That would be your regular old propyl. Does that make sense, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
If you guys had a bond right there, that would go to what kind of propyl?
Cyclopropyl.
Okay, are we all right with all the different ways we can do a propane, a propyl? Yes, no, maybe Sophie? Okay. All right, so we've got isopropyl. And what's right here? Regular old propyl. One, two, three. Again, you guys, don't include the carbon on the ring. That confuses a lot of students. You start out here, one, two, three. So we've got a regular old propyl. Okay. Now, you guys,
answers on these based on the alphabet, okay? That's only when you have the exact same numbering two different ways. We want to do how we learned and number it so we give everything the lowest number possible. So you guys are going to start one of your branches on carbon number one because that makes sense, right, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we could do one isopropyl or one propyl or one 1-dimethyl. Which one makes sense to start your one at?
One 1-dimethyl.
1-1-dimethyl, because you want to get a 1 and a 1, right, you guys? You're going to have four numbers, and you want to start with 1-1. If you put it here, you'd have 1-2-2. Do you guys see what I mean?
Yeah.
Okay. If you put it here, you'd have 1 and then 3-3-4 or 1-4-5-5. Yeah. And you wouldn't want that. So do you guys get why I started the 1 down there? So in your numbering set, you're going to have a 1 and a 1. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. So we've got 1, 1, and then we're going to have another number here and another number here because we've got four branches. Now, does it make sense to go 1-3-5 or what? Sorry, 1-1-3-5 or 1-1-2-5?
1-1-2-5.
Yes. You want to choose where you'll have the lowest number. So we would go this way. Now if I started somewhere else, I just want to show you guys when we gave this example. Some of you guys said, let's go this way. That would give us 1-2-2. Oh wait, what mistake did I make? Oh no, I didn't make a mistake. 1-2-2-4. Sometimes when it's this close to you, it's hard to see what you're doing. But when it's that far away, it's easier to see. So right here we have 1. Those are the same. This is the point of difference right here. This is a lower number, so we go with this one. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we're not going to do the blue one. Okay, so we've got a 1-1-dimethyl. We have a 2-propyl. And we have a 5-isopropyl. I hear some whispering out there, guys. Is there a question for me? No, we're okay. Don't be scared to ask me. That's what you pay me for. Okay? Answer your questions. Okay, so we have 1-1-dimethyl, we've got a 2-propyl, and we've got a 5-isopropyl. Okay, now we put them in order in the name based on what? The alphabet. Now, isopropyl and propyl, those aren't hard to figure out because there's I and there's P there. And the iso part is not a Greek prefix in terms of a number, like 2, 3, or 4. And it's not hyphenated like tertiary or sec, okay? It's part of the name. We can't have isopropyl without iso. But the dimethyl, which letter are we going to go with?
The M.
When you guys are working these problems, just have your notes out. So you can go back to that slide and go, okay, what? Iso doesn't count, but dimethyl does count, or the other way around, or what am I doing? Okay, just have that out. All right, so who's going to come first in our I comes first, and then what?
Time comes on the full.
Okay, then we're going to put a hyphen, and we're going to put 1-1 dimethyl. And then what? And then what?
Cyclohexane.
Wow! Okay, so now you guys see why those names on your shampoo bottle are so long. Yeah? We're starting to see that?
Mm-hmm.
Did anyone look at it while you're in there this morning? No. Sometime this week you're going to look at it though, and you're going to be like, oh! And then you're going to feel all nerdy, but that's okay. That's what you paid for. Okay, questions from you guys. Okay. So, this stuff, again, I'm going to tell you guys, you just need to take practice, 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 because you're going to be looking at something and you're going to go, okay, when do I do the alphabet and when do I do the numbers? Because obviously 5 came before 1-1 here, but I needed to have 1-1 here, and not 1-2, and okay? Practice, practice, practice. All right, so let's draw a few. And most students prefer drawing it rather than naming it. Because when you draw it, it's like all the clues are already there for you. So what am I going to draw first for number 2?
I have a question for accounting.
Okay.
Does accounting differ when you're like drawing the structure versus a branch? Because the rule you said was, you start counting at 1 once your pencil touches the paper, and then the line would be 2, but then when you draw it, it's like 1 to 1 is that's 1. So it's a different counting for different.
So which one are we talking about? The bottom one?
Like if you draw like this square and you do the rule where you say you touch the pen, you touch the first touch counts as 1.
Mm-hmm.
So it'd be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. For like the second one.
For this one right here?
Yeah.
So 1, 2, 3, 4. And then when you draw this right here, you're not drawing another point. That was already there. So you're just connecting them.
Oh, okay. So
it's
the same thing.
Yeah. Okay, so what am I gonna draw first for you guys? Heptane. And it's not a cycloheptane, it's just heptane. So we're gonna draw a caterpillar, and it's gonna have how many carbons? 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right. Now, at the beginning, it says 2 cyclopropyl. What does cyclopropyl look like? What shape, you guys? A triangle. So you guys are just going to locate your carbon number 2, and you're going to draw a bond, and then you're going to draw a triangle on it. Now, I'm going to number backwards just to be different, and I'm going to put a bond right here, and draw a triangle on it. Does that make sense, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
A student mistake that I see quite often is this. Drawing the triangle right there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you guys? That's not drawing a cyclopropane like that. You're gonna wanna do this one right here. So don't do that, okay? What the difference is that in this one, you've got 3 carbons up in your branch up there. And this one you just have 2 carbons up in your branch up there. Okay. All right, number 3, you guys. What am I going to draw?
Cyclopentane.
And that looks like that. A little house. Okay, what am I going to do now? You're going to draw a T. Does it matter which carbon we pick?
No.
No, just pick one and draw a T. Most of us will draw it right on top so it looks like a church. But I'll draw it like that just so you can see it can be down there. Question?
Sorry, it's on the first one I just did.
Uh-huh.
Can you do that on the other side?
Could I have drawn it right there?
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
I just want it to be different and
okay.
Number it backwards.
And it has to be a triangle.
Yes. And then we've got 2-bromo and 1,1-diethyl. Okay. So can we draw the bromine first?
No.
You're doing the drawing. Could you draw the bromine first if you want?
Sure.
Yeah. Can you put it anywhere on the square?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You sure can. So you can put the bromine right there. But bromine is on carbon number 2. So you have to put 2 methyls either here or here because they have to be on carbon what?
1.
So if bromine is on carbon 2, either this is carbon 1 or that's carbon 1. Are we okay with that, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So most of us will just go ahead and put a couple of methyls right there. And then we have 1,1-dimethyl on that side, and we have a 2-bromo on the other side. So that would mean that we numbered it like that. Okay. Now, what else is on carbon number 2 that we don't see there, but we're supposed to know is there? A hydrogen. So if you see a carbon only bonded to 3 things in the line bond structure, we assume that you know that there's also a hydrogen there. What's on carbons 3 and 4, my friend?
Mm-hmm.
2 hydrogens, because those 2 carbons are bonded to 2 other carbons, so we assume that there are 2 hydrogens there. Are the line bond structures making sense to you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good, good. Questions for me? Okay. All right. So if this is on the handout, did everybody get the handout? Okay. So we got a couple of reactions to talk about. And they're not hard at all. Alkanes will do something called halogenation. And that means that we're pulling off one of the hydrogens and we're sticking on a halogen. Now remember, our halogens are in group 7A or 17 right here. Fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. Does everyone remember that those are our halogens? We're good with that? Okay, so what we're doing is putting one of those onto our alkane. And because we're ripping off a hydrogen and substituting the hydrogen with something else, usually a bromine or a chlorine, this is a type of substitution reaction. So that's why that says that right there. So one atom is just replaced by another, or one atom is substituted for another. Okay? So if we have an alkane right here, and see how we have bonds and we don't see what it's bonded to? That's just telling you it doesn't matter. It's bonded to something else there, but who cares? What we're interested in is this hydrogen right here. And now it's going to react with a halogen. And the X right there means a general halogen. So this could be BrBr or ClCl. Does that make sense to you guys? Okay, so when we say it's a halogen and we don't care which one it is, we do that. Or you guys will see X with the subscript 2, because halogens come in 2s, Br2 or Cl2 or F2. Do you remember that also?
Mm-hmm.
Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay. So we're going to give that either light or a little bit of heat, and the hydrogen's going to get plucked off, and it's going to be replaced by one of the halogens, and then the hydrogen that came off will find the other halogen, and what we'll get is an alkyl halide. So instead of an alkene and a halogen, now we have an alkyl halide. Okay, so the ending of the names just gets a little bit of a change, but that's not going to freak us out, right, you guys? Okay, and then we get this guy over here, which is called a hydrogen halide, because you have hydrogen and a halogen. Okie dokie, smokies. Yes, in the back.
Your battery's low on the phone.
Oh, okay, great. Let's see if I brought my charger with me. I would bet that I didn't do that. You brought yours? Yay! Okay. So first of all, let's keep it charged. Second of all, let's see if I have 2 hours of lecture.
Thanks for letting me know that. Did it work? There we go. Is it still recording? I need my glasses. Can you see that? Is it still recording?
Yes.
Oh, awesome. Okay.
Great. Thank you for that. Okay, so an example of this, we've got ethane, and it's going to react with bromine. And remember I said our halogens come in two, so we've got Br2 there. And we're going to pull off any of these hydrogens here. It doesn't matter. We still get the same product. And to keep in mind the example up there, we put the bromine on the end, but it could have gone here, 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 doesn't matter. And then we're going to get an HBr. Okie dokie, smokies? Not too bad of a reaction? We can do this on the exam? Yes?
Does it also have to go in alphabetical order? Since bromine is before ethane?
Oh. Ethane is the parent here, and bromine is the branch. So you change bromine into bromo, and you just say bromoethane. If we did a chlorine on it, it would be chloroethane. Are we okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If it was a longer chain, if it was a pentane, and you put it right in the middle, that would be a 3-bromopentane or a 3-chloropentane. Okie dokie. Answer maybe? Yes.
If you did plus Br and H, like the Br bonded to the H, is that okay? Or does it have to be the H to the Br?
Oh, if you did that?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's totally fine.
Okay.
Just convention has us putting H first.
Okay.
Because that's how chemists do it. But yeah, that's fine. You'll also see the lone pairs that drawn in there sometimes that you don't see, but most of the time we just assume you know that there are lone pairs on a halogen, and then there are no lone pairs on a hydrogen because hydrogens don't like lone pairs. And if you draw them on a hydrogen, I'm going to put unhappy face on your test. Deal? Okay. So let's do a few of these, you guys. So we've got methane, and it's going to react with CO2. And we're going to give it a little bit of light so it can happen. So what are you going to draw for your first product, you guys?
H3.
Okay. So the person brave enough to answer me said a CH3. And what's going to be on the right-hand side?
Cl.
A Cl. Is everybody okay with that? Now, if you guys wanted to go ahead and put in the lone pairs on the chlorine, that's fine too. But if you leave them off, then you don't have any worry about getting the number of lone pair electrons wrong on that. Okay? So, warning there. And what is going to be the other product?
HCl.
Yeah, HCl. Okay. So, we have the chloromethane. Or methyl chloride, we'll see both of those names for that one. And if you guys drew those two products, then you got it right. Okay, so the next one we have, what's that thing there?
Cyclopropane.
Cyclopropane, yes. Where are the hydrogens? We have 3 carbons. And what this structure does, it assumes that you know where the hydrogens are. How many hydrogens on each carbon in the cyclic structure?
Two,
because each of the carbons is bonded to 2 other carbons, so there's only room for 2 hydrogens. Now, does it matter on this one which hydrogen we pull off?
Mm-hmm.
Nope, it doesn't, because they're all the same. So we're going to go ahead and draw a triangle, and most of us will probably draw the chlorine bonded to the top like that, just because that's what we do, right, you guys? And the other product will be what?
H-chlorine.
H-C-L. a hydrogen. There's a hydrogen, you may draw the bond and a hydrogen here, and still there's two hydrogens here and here. All right, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
We okay with this?
Mm-hmm.
We can do this on the exam all day long. Okay, that brings us to the end of chapter 12. Yay! All right, how much time do I have? My phone is over there. Oh, have lots of time, huh? You guys are like, no, no, please stop. Okay. On to chapter 13. Okay, so chapter 13, you guys, is unsaturated. Those are alkenes, and those were in chapter 12. Now, what are we talking about when we're talking about saturation versus unsaturation? We're talking about hydrogens. Now, in order to make a double bond, you have to pull a hydrogen off of this carbon and a hydrogen off of this carbon, because the carbons would not want to have the double bond there and still have a couple of hydrogens off of them, because then they would be bonding or have five bonding pairs of electrons around them, and that would be above the octet rule, okay? So if you were to stick the hydrogens on there and destroy that double bond so that each of these carbons right here had two hydrogens, you would be saturating the molecule with hydrogens. And if you don't have any double bonds or triple bonds, then you're saturated. So is everybody okay with the whole saturated versus unsaturated thing? And I only went into an explanation like that for you guys because you'll see those words a whole lot. Okay, so alkenes. These are compounds that have at least one what? At least one double bond. So they can have more than one double bond, but they've got to have at least one double bond. And these things are sometimes called olefins, and they have a general formula that's the same as our cycloalkanes. You guys can see there on the slide that it's CnH2n instead of H2n plus 2. So if you have a double bond, you had to get rid of a hydrogen off consecutive carbons in order to make the double bond. Okay, so ethylene, this is going to be our simplest alkene. So our alkenes can start with two carbons. You don't have alkenes that only have one carbon, because how do you double bond to yourself? Right, you guys? So we don't have that. We all right with that? Okay. So if we look at the bottom here, instead of the name ethane, E-T-H-A-N-E, if we have a double bond, then it changes to ethene. And that should make sense because this is an alkene, E-N-E, so it should have that ending. Does that make sense, you guys? Okay, so if we had three carbons and we had a double bond, that wouldn't be propane, that would be what?
Propane.
Propane. Yay, you guys get it. And the simplest one, like I said, is called ethene, and it also has a common name, which is kind of confusing, ethylene. And it's confusing because when we see a Y, we're expecting a triple bond, because it's alkynes with a Y, that means a triple bond. But don't worry about it, that's just the old name that people still use, okay? Any questions on this for me, you guys? No. Does anyone know where we use ethene or ethylene? So this is used in the fruit industry when they want that not only is it an alkene, it has a cool little kiwi structure, and also it smells good. It smells like what?
Pine.
Yeah, like pine trees. And this is a stuff that you smell if you've ever smelled pine salt. Okay? This is called alpha pinene. So this is a little alpha symbol right there. So I'll try to remember to get the stock room to make me up a little sample so you guys can pass it around, because I like to pass around samples of this stuff, because research says that smell like evokes the best and longest held memories. Has anyone heard that?
Mm-hmm.
Like if you just like walk into a room and there's a certain smell, it could like remind you of someone who's long gone or something like that. One person's like, yeah, the rest of you guys are like, you're crazy. Anyways, okay. So, here you guys go. Here is a chart showing you the first six. So we've got ethene at the top, and there's only one place for that double bond to go because you only have two carbons, and it has to go between two carbons. Propene. Propene is going to be a chain that has three carbons and a double bond in it. Now notice that we don't have to say one ethene or one propene because there's only one place for the double bond to go. What I just said is really obvious in ethene, but when we look at propene, think about this. If I move the double bond over here, then the double bond would start at carbon what?
Two.
Actually, it would start at carbon one because you change the numbering. Here you go 1, 2, 3 because you want the double bond to start at carbon 1. But if we moved it over here, you'd go, okay, well then let's number this way. 1, 2, 3. And you'd still be starting the double bond at carbon 1. So it would be 1 propene either way. Are you guys okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
If you still don't get what I'm saying, take this molecule and flip it around. Exact same thing, you're still going to have 1 propene. Then we get to 1-butene right here. Now, you need to say the 1 on butene because you can have 1-butene or you can have 2-butene. Does that make sense, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we put the double bond over on this side, that would be what?
1-butene.
That would be 1-butene. It wouldn't be 3-butene. 1-butene because you'd number this way. But 1-butene is definitely different from 2-butene. So we need to indicate which one it is, 1 or 2-butene. Are we okay with that, you guys? All right, 1-pentene. 1-pentene, you can start the double bond at carbon 1 and have it between carbons 1 and 2. Or you can have a 2-pentene, which would put the double bond right here. So we have to indicate which one it is. Now if I moved it on over here, that would be what?
1-pentene.
That would be 1-pentene. And if I had it here, it'd be what?
2-pentene.
It'd be 2-pentene because you guys would number it backwards. You could say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now notice with 1-pentene, you don't need to say 1-2-pentene. You just say 1-pentene because you're saying the double bond starts at carbon 1. And it has to be between carbons what and what if it starts at carbon 1? 1 and 2. So that's obvious, so you don't need to put 1, 2. You don't have a double bond between carbons 1 and 3. Does that make sense? You okay with that, Hunter, maybe? Okay. Now, 1-hexene. We can have 1-hexene. We can have 2-hexene, and the 1-hexenes would be here, here. And the 2-hexenes would be here, here, or we can have what?
3-hexene.
Okay? And again, that same, where does that double bond start? Which carbon does it start? Okie dokie, smokies. Okay, so there's a couple of different versions right there, the full structural formula and the condensed structural formula. We can also draw it with line bond structures. So if we're looking at pentene, what we would do is we'd say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and we draw another line between carbons 1 and 2. You can draw the line below the first line or above the first line, but convention is that you draw it condensed or line bond, which is also called the skeletal formula. And then you guys will not be drawing ball and stick and space filling. Those are just things you will see. So you'll need to be able to see all five of those structures and realize, oh, okay, that's a protein. Okie dokie, smokies? All right. Physical properties on these. They're super similar to alkenes. So they tend to be flammable and nonpolar because there aren't any electronegative atoms in there to suck the electrons to one side of the molecule or the other. So we don't have holes. We don't have partial negative or partial positive. Okay? Which means they're insoluble in water because remember, light dissolves light, and water is what? Polar or nonpolar?
Polar.
It's polar. These guys are nonpolar and they're not going to like each other. These tend to have low melting and boiling points. It doesn't take very much energy to get them apart because you don't have a lot of the dipole-dipole interactions. And they tend to have a low density. So that means that they're going to sink or float when you put them with water.
Float.
Okay. Is everybody okay with this? Okay. So limonene. Limonene is one of those molecules that smells good too, and hopefully I'll be bringing that in for you guys tomorrow. And you guys can see there that we've got a couple of double bonds and we've got a ring structure there, so that's an interesting little molecule. This chart down here is just showing you all of this stuff above here, and it's comparing one hexene to hexane and showing you that you have similar trends there. So the boiling point and the melting points, they tend to be pretty low. You can see the melting point where it goes from solid to liquid is pretty low. And then the boiling point here is above room temperature. Room temperature is what, you guys? 25 degrees Celsius. Even if it's not 25 degrees Celsius in this classroom right now in science, room temperature is 25 degrees Celsius. So these, hexene and hexane, they're 6 carbons long. So we're in what phase there, you guys? Like, we haven't boiled yet. And we've got a medium-sized alkene or alkane. Liquid, yes. And hexane is one of those liquids that's used as a nonpolar solvent in the organic lab quite often. Okay? So are those numbers making sense to you guys? They don't turn into a gas until those temperatures. So those are their boiling. Their densities are less than 1, and who has a density of 1?
Water.
Water, really easy density there. So they're floating, and no water solubility, and the dipole moment, not really anything. Don't worry about this one. Don't memorize any of those numbers or anything. Okay, questions for me, you guys? The basic properties, characteristics of these? Yes?
Does that mean that these are smaller molecules?
Does that mean that these are small molecules?
Yeah, are these smaller since they tend to boil quicker? Would that make them a smaller molecule?
So the smaller molecules are usually things with 1 to 4 carbons, and those will be gases at room temperature. Those can be gases at room temperature. And then once you get to 5 carbons, and above, we're going into the liquid zone. Butane has 4 carbons, and if you ever have looked at a clear where you can see the liquid lighter, butane has a gas phase at the top and a liquid phase at the bottom. It's a little bit pressurized in the cigarette lighter there. So that one's kind of on the border of liquid gas. So am I answering your question?
I guess, yeah.
So in the last chapter, one of the slides said if you have 50 or above carbons, you tend to be a solid.
Okay.
Are we all right with this?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions, you guys? Okay. I don't have my phone on me. It's over there. I don't have a watch, so you guys are going to have to let me know when I have 5 minutes left, okay? Please. All right. So, so back to this. So, if we have
about this little guy at the end, this functional group, we'll get to these in another chapter, but looking at this right here, okay? This is a saturated fatty acid because it has as many hydrogens stuck to it as is possible. This one right here is an unsaturated fatty acid, and you guys can see it's got double bonds here. So that means we don't have as many hydrogens as is possible stuck to this chain. So if we took away this half of the double bond and this guy reached out and grabbed a hydrogen and this one reached out and grabbed a hydrogen, we would be saturating it, okay? And that's what we do when we make Crisco and things like that. We take unsaturated fatty acids, which tend to be liquids at room temperature, and we do a reaction that throws hydrogens at them, pew, 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 and these guys pick up hydrogens and they become saturated, and saturated fatty acids, they stack really well and have all those cool van der Waals forces between them, and that means that they tend to be in which phase?
Solid.
Yeah, solid. These guys right here, they're unsaturated, and these double bonds put little kinks in the chain. So if you have little kinks in your chain, it's hard to stack really well and get really close to each other. And so if you have a little bit of space between you, you're going to tend to be in which phase? In the liquid phase. So that's why our unsaturated fatty acids tend to be in the liquid phase, like olive oil, liquid, okay? And then butter has a lot of saturated fatty acids in it, so it's solid. Is this making sense chemically, you guys? Okay. So you guys can see the little pink right there that the double bond causes in the real molecules, so the real molecules aren't really straight. And you guys can see how this one is nice and straight and it makes it easy to pack these together and interact and be solid. Yes?
So health-wise, would unsaturated fats be better than saturated fats since they're using the breakup?
The question was, why are unsaturated fats better than saturated?
Like health-wise, would unsaturated be like healthier than saturated?
Yeah, I think it has to do with the fact that saturated fats, they'll form like the solids, and I think that just sticks to everything in our bodies. I think that's the way it works biochemically.
Like clog our arteries?
Yes, yes. And unsaturated fats don't do that. But then there's a question of coconut oil, which we all think is a super healthy thing lately, but it's got a high level of saturated fat in it, so that's one of those weird conundrums. Has anyone heard about that? Like, coconut oil is really good, it's really bad, it's the worst thing you can do for yourself, it's the best thing you can do for yourself. Don't brush your teeth, just put coconut oil in your mouth and go with it. Has everyone heard about that? All of these things, yeah. Okay. So that's the difference between saturated fatty acids and unsaturated fatty acids there. And it should make sense now that we think about, oh, I've heard that before because they talk about it all the time, you know, and diet stuff. So there we go. All right. So here is just another slide showing you guys what I just showed you. That our unsaturated fatty acids have double bonds in them. And you see how it says cis up there? We have two versions, one cis and one's trans. What the difference between cis and trans are, we will see that in the stereochemistry chapter, which I believe is chapter 15. Now, if you have a trans bond, that's going to give you a trans fatty acid, and we'll take a look at that a little bit later. So you're like, yay, I get to know the chemistry behind butter and Crisco and all that stuff. Okay, so we've got the fatty acid, and you usually have three fatty acids connected to a glycerol backbone like this, and that
molecules that can stack and become a solid. Say we want to make Crisco because we got to make pies for our holidays. What we'll do is we'll throw these unsaturated fatty acids into the presence of hydrogen gas. There it is right there. And that's going to need a catalyst to work. So what we have is the metal PB. Does anyone remember what PB is? PB is lead, but PD is what? Palladium. So we have palladium, and this right here is a carbon mount. So we put the palladium on top of carbon like that. And that's something in organic chemistry that you see a whole lot, H2PEC. And it just means you're hydrogenating something. You're sticking hydrogens on there. Now, have we heard of hydrogenated oils, you guys? Here it is in the chemistry behind it. We're going to hydrogenate this unsaturated fatty acid. And it's unsaturated because it's got what kind of bonds there? Double bonds. So it doesn't have all the hydrogens on each carbon that are possible. So, pew, 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 we're going to throw some hydrogens on there. And the carbons that are on either side of these double bonds are each going to pick up a hydrogen. And they're going to go from having one hydrogen to be CH2 and CH2. So now they're saturated. And because they don't have the little kinks in them that the double bonds cause, they form these nice straight chains that can pack together. And when you have molecules that are very closely packed together, you tend to be in which phase? Solid! And that's how we get margarine and Crisco and that type. Is that making sense, you guys? Yay! Okay. All right. A little bit about the bonds. A double bond is shorter than a single bond, and it's also stronger than a single bond. Is that okay with us? What's the PM down there? It's not the opposite of AM. It's a picometer. So you guys remember micrometer, nanometer from 2A? That's just a picometer. That means even smaller, okay? So you guys can see that the double bond is smaller than the single bond, and the triple bond is going to be even shorter. Any questions on that? We can answer a really easy multiple choice question on Monday about that. Which of these bonds is likely to be the shortest? And be like, aha, right? Yay, okay. Okay, so structure and bonding. So what we have around each of these carbons here is three bonds. So do you guys remember the whole geometry thing from 2A and the fact that we reviewed it a little bit yesterday and the day before? Okay. So if you have a central atom right here and it's bonded to three things, those electrons and those bonds are going to try to get as far apart as possible. So that was VSEPR. You guys remember that? Mm-hmm. Valence shell electron VSE pair repulsion theory. There, we got it. Okay. And that's going to give us a trigonal planar geometry, and each of those bonds is going to be 120, and the exact same thing happens at that carbon right there. Trigonal planar, and all of those bonds are, how many degrees, you guys? 120. So with our alkanes, each of our carbons had tetrahedral geometry, because each of the carbons was bonded to four different things. And tetrahedral geometry gives you a bond angle of what? 109.5, okay? But around the carbons that are double bonded, you're going to see bond angles of 120. And this should be a little bit of a review for you guys. Yes? No, maybe so? Okay. All right. So we also have rules for naming alkenes. Yay! Another set of rules, right, you guys? They're pretty much the same as number one says we're gonna find the longest chain, which we are used to. But if you have a double bond, you have to find the longest chain that includes both of the carbons of the double bond. You cannot just do one carbon of the double bond. It has to include both carbons of the double bond. And if you take a look at the pictures up here, you can see that we're going to do the five-carbon chain right there because it includes both of the carbons of the double bond. And we wouldn't choose to do the six-carbon chain right there, even though that's the longest continuous carbon chain, because the six-carbon chain does not include what? Both carbons of the double bond. It has to include the whole double bond. So the longest carbon chain that includes the double bond is five carbons. So what we're going to do with the name is change the ending to indicate that we have a double bond. And that means that pentane changes into pentene. Is that okay with everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then if you're in the shower washing your hair, then it turns into pantene. My kids are always like, Mom, you're not allowed to tell Dad jokes. Your mom. I'm telling me dumb jokes I want. Okay. So then we're gonna have to number it. And you guys already got used to the fact on that one slide when I was talking about propene that we have to try to give the double bond the lowest number possible. Okay? So with this one up here, we're not going to number it four pentene. We're going to number it what?
One
pentene for the parent chain. And we'll deal with the changes later, you guys, okay? So we're not going to go one through five this way, because on UPAC says you need to get the double bond the lowest number possible. So we're going to go this way. So the parent would be a one. So it says number the chain so that the double bond has the lowest number possible and place that number before the parent chain. Place that number before the parent chain. Double bond takes precedence over substituents. So with alkanes, you guys, we looked at all of the branches and we tried to give the branches the lowest numbers possible. But with alkenes, the priority is the double bond. So the double bond needs to have the lowest number possible. And then we worry about the branches. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay. So at the bottom, you guys can see that we're going to call that one hexene and not five hexene. So after we identify what our parent chain is, and then we're going to identify the substituents, and we're going to number those, and then we're going to put the name together. So with this one up here, you guys, we see that we have the hexene, and either way you go, you're going to have three hexene. Does that make sense to us? If we went one, two, three this way, that would still be three hexene. Except over here we've got a branch. So we could do 5-methyl-3-hexene, or we could number it forwards, and that would give us 2-methyl-3-hexene. And IUPAC says, again, you want to have the lowest number possible. Okie dokie, Smokies?
The lowest number for the branch or for the double bond?
The lowest number for the double bond first. That takes priority. And then the lowest number for the branch. This would be 3-hexene either way. So then you have the choice of doing 2-methyl-3-hexene or 5-methyl-hexene. So you would choose the two. Okay? Now notice where the 3 for the hexene occurs, you guys. It's not out front. You don't say 2,3-methylhexene. And the reason is that if you put 2,3-methyl, the person who's looking at it would say, do you mean 2,3-dimethyl? Like, what are we talking about here? So why we put the 3 here is to indicate that the double bond is occurring between carbons 3 and 4. Okay? Does that make sense to us?
Mm-hmm.
All right. The supposed to do according to IUPAC, but nobody does that because people are like, why would I have a number in the middle of my word, okay? Unless you have a massively complicated molecule where there would be some kind of ambiguity if you didn't put the number right there. So if you see the number in the middle of a word, like, just know that most people don't do that. Okay, so what happens if you have more than one double bond? What are we gonna do? The same thing you guys did when you had more than one methyl or ethyl. You use Greek prefixes, di-tri and tetra, okay? So we're gonna use diene and triene, except we're gonna throw an A on the front because IUPAC says that's easier to say. A diene and a triene instead of diene and triene. So this one right here, we've got two double bonds and we've got six carbons, and you guys can see that your double bonds are going to be 1 and 5 or 1 and 5, either way. So we've got 1, 5, right, you guys? Okay. And then we're gonna say hex, and then you're gonna put a di right here. So if you put your finger over the A, you can see that it's saying 2 double bonds, 2 enes. So I'm sorry that it's in the middle of the word instead of at the front, like when we did dimethyl or diethyl, but that's how it is, okay? When we're talking about double bonds, you put the Greek prefix right next to the ending to indicate we've got two double bonds. Where are they? Well, that comes before it over there. Okie dokie smokies. Do you guys see all the little tiny things that will mess you up? Okay, so on our next example, we've got 2-methyl-1,3-butadiene. So if we didn't know the name and we were looking at this molecule, we'd go, okay, I've got two double bonds. I need to get the longest carbon chain possible that includes both of my double bonds. That's gonna be this guy right here. And then I need to number it so my double bonds have the lowest number possible. I'm not going to worry about that branch up there right now because IUPAC told me that the double bonds get priority. So I can do 1 and 3, or I can number it backwards and do 1 and 3. Aha! It doesn't matter if I look at that, but it does matter which way I number it if I look at the fact that I have a branch here. Does that make sense, you guys? Okay. So it's going to be 1,3-butadiene either way, but you can do 2-methyl-1,3-butadiene, or if you numbered backwards, it would be 3-methyl-1,3-butadiene. So we would go with the one that gave us the lower number. Are we okay with that? Okay. So 2-methyl out here is saying that we've got a methyl branch. Where is it? It's on the second carbon. Okay. Now, the butadiene right here, we're saying the buta right here, that we've got 4 carbons, okay? 4 carbons, and the ene is telling us that we've got a double bond, and the di is saying we've got 2 of those. Well, where are they? Well, they're between carbons 1 and 2, and between carbons 3 and 4. All right, you guys? Okay, now the 1 and the 3, sometimes they get placed in the middle of name, but most people don't do that. Ah! Right? And then watch out when we have both double and triple bonds in the same molecule. Ay, ay, ay! Okay, so let's do some problems. How are we doing on time, you guys? 2:55, so we can do a couple of problems and then get out of here. Okay, you might want to try the first one, and please don't be scared. We'll help you out, and you do not need to be a pro and get this correct right away, the whole thing. You're learning, okay? Anyone want to try it? Okay, in the back, my friend in the back wants to try it. Shout at us.
It is 2, 5 inside.
Okay, you want to say methylheptene as in 7, right?
Yeah.
Heptene. Okay, so let's see how he did here. So what he said is, I need to have the longest continuous carbon chain that includes both of the carbons around that double bond. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That one won't matter right there. 1, 2, 3, 4, obviously no. So maybe we're gonna go with that one right there. Does that make sense, guys?
Yeah.
Okay. So we have a 7-carbon chain, and we want to decide whether we're gonna number left to right or right to left. What do you guys think? Okay, so IUPAC says, first of all, that double bond takes priority, and you're going to ignore those substituents, okay? You need to get the double bond to have the lowest number possible first. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So it either starts on carbon 4, or it's going to start on 1, 2, 3, carbon 3. Which one do we want, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Carbon 3. So we're going to number backwards. So that means that our parent is a 3-pentene. Does that make sense to us, you guys? Heptene. Yes, thank you for correcting me. 3-heptene. Okay. So this one wasn't symmetrical, which meant that there would be two options. So we've already determined that we have to number in one direction. So that's good, because it means that those methyls are definitely on carbons 2 and 5. We don't have to do any choosing here. So what we would say is 2,5-dimethyl 3-heptene. So how did our friend in the back do? Really well, right? He just missed that one little piece, that 3-heptene, telling us where the double bond was in our parent chain. Are we okay with that, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
No? Did
yes.
I hear a no?
Yeah.
Yes?
Where did the 3 come from again?
Right here, your double bond is between carbons 3 and 4, so we just state that it starts on carbon 3.
You go from the smallest one?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So it must be between carbons 3 and 4 if it starts on carbon 3, so you only need to say 3. Okay? So this up top, awesome. Thank you in the back. We were just missing that 3. Also, you guys, you could see 2,5-dimethylhept-3-ene, but nobody does that. Okay, and the reason they said that is if you put the 3 right next to the ene, definitely your reader will see that that double bond starts on carbon 3. But most people can figure it out with this version. Okay, any questions for me, you guys? We're okay with this?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's do one more, you guys. Let's do this bottom one, and let's save that one for tomorrow. Okay, so there's a double bond there, and it's a cyclic structure. So we've got to number that thing. So does it matter whether we go 1, 2, or 1, 2?
Mm-hmm.
No, either way, your double bond is going to start on carbon 1, and you're going to have a methyl group on carbon 1 and a methyl group on carbon 2, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this one doesn't matter, but most of us will go 1, 2, down, just because that's what we do, right, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we'll go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You absolutely cannot go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 like that, because you can't have a double bond between carbons 1 and 6. It has to be consecutive numbers. Also, that would be putting your methyl groups on carbon 1 and 6, and IUPAC says it's a big no-no in terms hexene, right? Because there's six carbons and it has a double bond, so it has to have the ene ending, right? But it's a cyclic structure, so we have to put wood at the front.
Cyclo, good.
So this one is a cyclohexene. Now, if it's a cyclic structure, we would put the thing that has priority on carbon one always, because those are the rules. Make sense to you guys? Okay. So you guys can say one cyclohexene to indicate that a double bond is going to start on carbon one. But in this case, you don't need to. But I'll go ahead and write it in there for some people who need to see that. All right. So can you guys put together the name for me? What are we going to start with?
One, two.
Good. So we're going to start with the branches. And I heard a lot of you guys say dimethyl. Good. Yes. 1,2-dimethylcyclohexene. You could also say 1,2-dimethyl-1-cyclohexene. You could also say 1,2-dimethylcyclohexene.